Hello, I'm Alexander, and today's video will be an unboxing and first impressions of my very first CNC. In this video, I will go over the specs, setup, testing, and then show the very first objects that I machined, both of wood and aluminum. Without further ado, let's get into the video. I had originally planned to build my own CNC using 3D printed parts and then machining aluminum parts to replace those plastic ones. After a lot of research, I decided that it would be better for me to get a small, cheaper CNC to practice, and if I decide to build a CNC in the future, this would help to determine what specs and features I should include. The reason I have selected this model was it allowed me to get a full 5-axis CNC for about $1,000 Canadian when the exchange rate, shipping fees, and custom charges were added. Some of the specs include a build volume of 180 by 270 by 95mm XYZ volume, a 400-watt air-cooled DC spindle, ER11 collet, NEMA 23 stepper motors, power supply, controller boards, and accessories. Another reason why I chose this model was the detailed description, where they included many pictures with detailed dimension callouts. When unboxing, I was delighted to find that there was no damage during shipping. Inside the main box, there were two smaller boxes. One held the 4th and 5th axes, and the other held the control box. Additional accessories, such as the tools and some starting end mills, were provided. Also, I was quite pleased with the thickness of the linear rails and the use of ball screws rather than lead screws, like other cheap CNCs use. This, coupled with the aluminum extrusion frame, resulted in a more rigid machine than I had expected. The only assembly required was plugging in the cords to the main control box and applying the cable wrap. Specifically, some of the accessories that were included in this kit were wrenches, chuck keys, Allen or hex keys, a tool homing sensor, clamping mechanisms, wood dowels, and plastic blanks. With regards to included end mills and collets, there is a 1/8 inch collet in the machine, and I received an additional 1/8 and quarter inch collet, two 1/8 inch ball mills, two 1/8 flat end mills, several engraving bits, and some micro drill bits were also included. Before I wired up the CNC, I cracked open the controller box and took a peek inside. Here you can see the stepper motor driver and the main control board. At one point I knew which model this was, but it seems to be a pretty common board you can find online easily. The ability to plug the USB cable into this board is a major quality of life improvement over trying to adapt a parallel port connector to new computer hardware. Onto the wiring. For the spindle, they officially recommend wrapping the copper ends around the threaded connector and using the knob to clamp it in place. This kind of sketched me out a bit, so I decided it was probably safer to crimp connectors on the ends and then clamp these in place instead. Here's a quick clip of me adding the connectors. Once I was finished wiring up the spindle, I then plugged in the 5 cables, one for each axis stepper motor. Then the cable wrap was applied. The cable wrap provided was the old-fashioned swirly kind rather than the sleeves, which are quicker to install. I then attached the tool height sensor and plugged the interface cord into the control box and then the computer. Hooray, we should be good to go. Sadly, the CNC rookie was not good to go. By default, Mach 3 is unable to run through a USB port. However, after surfing the web, I learned that an additional plugin is required, and after contacting the seller, I was provided the plugin via a Dropbox that corresponded to the correct controller board version. Now, we should get some movement. With Mach 3 set up, I then ran some tests moving the axes manually to verify operation. Then, I ran a quick program well clear of the stock. I did also write a simple program to verify that all 5 axes were able to move at the same time, as some other cheap machines that I was looking at could only operate the A and B axes separate from the XYZ. Before I started practicing on a real material, I took some of the more plasticky foam from the packing and ran the program through it. Then, to quickly determine the general capability of machining wood, I manually controlled the machine and took a few passes through some MDF. Similarly, my excitement also led me to manually test if aluminum was also possible on this machine. I was surprised when it not only milled the aluminum, but also created small but legitimate chips rather than dust. The spindle seems to have some noticeable vibrations or oscillations when at the maximum setting, so I've currently settled for running at about 70% speed. Since cutting the foam went smoothly, I decided now to take a shot at milling wood. I started with some facing operations to help determine the appropriate feed and speed. Then, I followed up with a 2D adaptive clearing and 3D scallop operation to add a slot with filleted edges. I ended up creating the same slot 3 times, and as my confidence built up with each successful program, the time required for the job was significantly reduced. The first attempt took 1.5 hours, and the last one took 20 minutes. I'm sure I can still get this down significantly as I continue to get better with CAM. While machining wood, I ran into another issue. My X-axis was starting to skip or experience layer shifts. After some investigation, I was able to determine that the issue was the set screws on the coupler between the stepper motor and the ball screws were very loose. To prevent this issue from occurring, I applied blue Loctite and torqued the screw. I also treated the other axes to this as a precaution. Personally, I'm more interested in machining parts rather than engraving objects, but since I have the bits, I decided to do some tests anyways. I ended up just engraving a name and phrase on a flat piece of wood. Then, the text was colored in to help it stand out from the stock. Then, I proceeded to face some aluminum. Unless I used a significant amount of WD-40, I'd run into issues. Now, after using higher quality end mills, it seems like bit dullness was the main issue and has since been resolved. After facing, I was unsure what to do with this part, so I decided to engrave my name similar to that of a dog tag. Again, the same engraving bits that were provided were used, with no issues to report. When done, I cut off the finished part and knocked down the edges with a file. To try out a 2D adaptive clearing tool operation with aluminum, I used some mini end mills that had just arrived. Here I am milling out a part that resembles a square from a periodic table. Then, I used a 2D contour to separate the part from the stock. Overall, I am very happy with what I have for the price I paid. This machine is a welcome addition to my toolbox and will allow me to make some metal parts for future projects I have planned where 3D printed parts just won't cut it. Due to the size and bulk of the machine being aluminum, it is very light, which is good for moving around, but bad for resonant vibrations while milling, so I also recommend either bolting or clamping it down to a solid workbench for use. In the future, I plan to add a pressurized air line to help with chip clearance, covers to protect the ball screws and linear rails, and testing of feed rates and speeds. I'm hoping to do several videos on my tests to the channel regularly, so stay tuned for more of those between my other content. I also hope to run a full 5-axis job soon too. After I use the machine some more, I may even make a full-on review. Thanks for watching, see you soon.